this too. How much of this renewable energy has to be made in state? Let's say we fall a little short. Just to make that goal, are you going to sacrifice areas that are ecologically sensitive or important lands to people? Or maybe you have to get another 15% from out of state. And also, just two more things to close. It was Tony Klein's Energy Committee that eliminated the environmental court just a couple of years ago. It was only a few years back. And that's why the law went in the way it did. So my other thought is to reinstate the environmental court, and at least on some of these larger projects, consider, at least on some of these projects, to put in Act 250. I mean, we need to decipher what is really a low-impact, environmentally friendly green energy project, and what's nothing more than big energy masquerading as green energy. And I think that's important to draw that, you know, that conclusion, to have some kind of standard or something. So it's kind of frustrating, but yeah, I hope something comes of this, you know, because, geez, it seems like going on how many years now with the wind?
Thanks, Pete. A long time.
A long time. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Yep. Who else? Yes, sir.
My name is Scott Woodward. I presented some comments a few weeks ago when the team was in Woodstock, and I presented testimony back in March as well. And my comments today are one about outreach, and there's obviously a lot of mistrust, and I think there are some folks who are never going to be convinced one way or the other on either end of the spectrum. But I think one of the shortcomings we've had, at least since I've been involved in this, is probably in the rush to get goals and hit goals, that we could have done better in outreach. And so I would hope that this task force makes outreach a focus and figures out whatever the definition of the problem is, that we figure out what the outreach needs to be to go along with the solution. And so that's one comment. The other is, in order to hit the goals, we need to be a little bit more visible as a state about our progress, because I've sat in on a lot of discussions and heard about the progress we're making, but I don't think that we really need to showboat the progress we're making as we make it, because I don't think the public is really truly aware of what the progress is, and I think we could really do much better. And so one of the things to accompany the solutions, it might be good to set, for example, in the business school, we have key performance indicators. And it might be good to establish a couple of those for the work that this task force does, so that it can promote the ultimate solutions. And then one last comment is about one of the favorite examples to trot out is the old harvest store silos, and how it was such a problem back then and nobody liked them, but look how we got used to them. But I don't think that that's an appropriate comparison, and I highlighted that in my testimony, because, and this is my personal feeling, I think it would be good for people to reflect on it individually, because it is an individual thing. But when I drive by a silo, a harvest store silo or any other silo, and I see a farm, I feel a pretty direct connection with that farm. I feel like I'm getting something out of it. Like I could go buy produce or meat or something from that farm. And so I instantly have some kind of connection with almost any farm I drive by in Vermont. And I don't get that feeling when I drive by a solar array. I just don't. But maybe we could. Maybe we could create a connection. I think that's been one of our failures, is there are some true believers who will always get a connection, but I think the average runner, if we want to try and make a connection with solar, we should figure out how to do that. But I think for that reason, the old harvest store silos is just not a good example, because I think any of us who drive by a farm can make a connection, like, yeah, I'm getting something out of that. But I don't think we get that driving by the solar. So maybe we can figure out how to achieve that.
Okay.
John Lewandowski, I'm a selectman in Newark, but I'm here speaking for myself today. Couple of things. One, I have three points I brought up here today. One is the land use calculations. Land use calculations, we talk about it possibly being less because solar becomes more efficient. It does. But we are counting on Vermonters, residents, and businesses to start using heat pumps. So we're going to heat with electric. We're looking at electric cars. We're going to drive electric. This could virtually triple the demand of electricity in Vermont alone. So now we're not talking about the same electricity anymore. Second thing, net metering. Where is the threshold on net metering and we will reach this if we continue as we're going, where we're going to be putting the infrastructure costs on the shoulders of whoever, for one reason or another, hasn't gone solar or whatever, or the infrastructure is going to collapse from neglect because there's nobody to pay for it unless we start taxing it. And the third one is referring to Tony Klein's Act 56. When we just had Searsburg and a smattering of solar projects around the state, you know, not mostly individual solar, we were looking at about roughly a 4% carbon footprint from electric generation. From what I understand now, and I think it can be verified, is that since we put in three more major wind facilities, we put in a whole lot more of solar, we are now up to about 6% of our solar footprint coming from electric. So can we really afford to continue on this route? Maybe we're doing something wrong. Maybe the solar isn't, maybe the wind isn't, maybe we need to just look at the whole picture too. Appreciate it, thanks.
Thank you, thanks John. Yes, ma'am.
Instead of walking all the way around.
Yeah,
okay. I'm Jill DeVoe, I'm from New Haven. And I apologize for my attire. I was literally outstanding in my field with a developer before I jumped in my car to race over here. They want to put in a solar field directly behind my property on an agricultural field. Adam knows, Chris knows, Annette knows. It's in Addison County. And I am overjoyed to hear you all speaking of using buildable space, saving our green space. And this solar array that they want to put in is going to be the first rotating array in the state. So there's going to be a sound issue that we're going to have to be dealing with as well. We already have one small private array next to us. They want to put this one in behind us. Then they want to put another one in across the street near a cemetery, and then another one right down the road around the corner. So Addison County is, you know, wide open spaces. We're just getting slammed. You know, fair and field days is right near where I am and where all these fields are going in. And the buildable space, I know it's more expensive. Utilize those rooftops. It would improve the fairgrounds. These people are coming in, like you say, in nice flat areas, in, out, boom, they're making the most amount of income that they can. I am for renewable energy, but my handout is all about responsibility. All the different little areas of what I see are not being taken into account. And I'm really, really glad I came today because I've enjoyed listening to each of you speak and knowing that there are some really great people behind, you know, what's going on in our state. The handout that I gave was pretty much an article that they printed in the Addison Independent, and it was right next to Governor Shumlin's article about his progress with solar fields. So it was kind of a little, you know. But I appreciate everybody doing what you're doing, and like I say, I hope that, you know, the responsibility gets taken into factor. And if you would please read through my handout, I'd really appreciate it. So,
thank you so much. Thanks.
Yes.
Whichever end you would like to be at.
Just preface. I'm Peter Rothschild. I'm on the Planning Commission at New Haven. Testified three times up here on this thing. And rather than get into my own personal beliefs, I thought it would be interesting just to comment on some of the comments that the committee has made. Chris, you made one. Don't leave siting up to a developer. 100% correct. That ties into the economic model, which in my opinion is a distortion. Senator Bray pointed out, we get poor siting as a result of competitive bidding where it's the race to the bottom. And we've seen and actually fought with certain developers to have an array moved 100 feet. And the lawyer calls back the homeowner and says, but that would cost us, you know, too much money. Well, if putting up a new pole knocks out the economic viability of a project, it shouldn't be there. I worked with Adam Lucci quite a bit earlier in this process. I put in about 400 hours into this thing and written the town plan for this, which sooner or later will get before our voters. In terms of screening, you can't screen a bad project. If it's sited poorly, you'll never screen it economically. There's one that Mr. Bo mentioned that's near you over on Field Days. It's Encore Redevelopment, 150 kW, sits on 10 acres, or rather 1 acre. And I went down there just to see what kind of screening was done because that came before our commission early on. They have trees 6 feet tall, evergreens planted every 50 feet. So if you can visualize a football field with six trees running down the length of it, that's the screening you get. It's zero. I mean, it's a waste of money. They should have never screened it. They should have never put it there if indeed they were sensitive to the homeowner. Ms. Markowitz, you mentioned growing pains. Absolutely. The issue is that they're probably not evenly distributed around the state. And to the point that some of these other folks made, Addison counties have disproportionate impact because of the coincidence of three phase and open fields. And that's, I think it's something y'all have to address, is how you incent the towns to be a part of your process. I fought trying to make something come in the middle in our town because I think it's a necessity that we do it, that we have solar. But the towns have no incentive to do it. They have every incentive to fight it. It's bizarre, but it's true. And a town looks at it and then they say, what do I get out of it? And the reality is right now, nothing. Mm-hmm. So I think that's something you should be looking at. Phase three extensions, be careful what you wish for. It's a brilliant idea to put it in some place so it ends up where there are, you know, only owls will see the arrays. But there's a pathway, and that three phase goes for as many miles as you want, and they cost a lot. And once they're in, you're going to find things cropping up right along the line. That's what we've seen. What else? Let me just see, make it quick. I do suggest if you can get the towns. I always thought I've talked with Senator Bray about it, may be impossible to do it legally and legislatively. But the town should be committed or strongly encouraged to produce X kilowatts, megawatts of power. And because that way you have a responsibility, and then let us solve the problems. And they told us we have to come up with, you know, 10 megs, 20, and figure it out. I think you need to get the towns involved with that process. Public comments in your project as you move forward, I would encourage you to be very careful about that. From the experience at Senator Bray's March joint session, I think you had 56 people speak. 20 of them came from Sun Common. And 16 of them did not admit they came from Sun Common. So you're going to get a totally distorted bunch of stuff if you don't really look at the source of the information and who's who. Your developers also are there's a complete normal distribution of from quality of developers. We've got some that are terrific and some that absolutely are dreadful. And the dreadful ones, I talked to Tony about it, I don't know how you deal with it. But the dreadful ones poison the well for the good ones. And you really, I don't think the industry, with respect to Ms. Stebbins, can adequately police itself when it comes to that, because it's proven that they don't. And lastly, just Stebbins mentioned 7,000 projects. Any idea how many of them are rooftops?
Probably, no.
Okay. My guess would that, based on our experience, in New Haven, I've never heard anyone complain about a rooftop, and the ill-sited, particularly 150s, are the biggest source of aggravation. Ms. DeVoe has a 2.2 that she has to deal with, and I don't think there's a perfect site, but myriad 150s will cause you a lot of grief. That much I can guarantee. So,
thank you, Peter.
My name's George Klein. I'm from Berrytown. I'm past president and business manager of International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 300. I've been a strong advocate for a diverse energy portfolio in the state. But presently, right now, I serve on the Berrytown Planning and Zoning Commission. And since sitting on that position, I can tell you that the process as it's engineered today is really bred a type of carpetbagger in Vermont with solar that's just indespicable. I've seen firsthand a total arrogance by either the developer or the developer's representative coming before the town and totally ignoring any type of our zoning proposals. I'd say that Tony talked about fairness. There is no fairness from what we see in our perspective is when these people come to for development. I don't think that any developer should really have the right to quitclaim Vermont's landscape for the purpose of making a profit, and that's clearly what these folks do. A couple things I may expand what you're thinking about and think maybe about an off-grid workshop or proposals, get people to be in the we're rural state, work that aspect, and encourage that. Also spoke about Addison County, about three-phase extensions. That's what's really eliminating some of the other areas where solar would be more attractive, less seen. I would maybe look at reducing the tariff for three-phase line extensions by the utility to make it more economical to develop these areas that are unseen. One of the things I'm proposing to put language in our town plan and our ordinances is if you build a solar array in an industrial park or in a commercial area, you will put up free solar charging stations for a vehicle. Now I can put that in our town plan, and guess what? That's totally ignored. It's not going to be heard or even talked about in going in there. But I'll tell you, we'll have it in our town plan. We're supporting something like that. But then again, it has no clout whatsoever. Thank you.
Thank you very much, George. Yes, sir.
You have a handout, so I'm not making up for everybody in the room, unfortunately. It's actually a white paper, and to give you a little bit of background, my name is George Gross, and I'm from Shoreham. Last year, I was a member of a group that formed the solar cooperative for a community scale 150 kilowatt solar array inshore. We also had to put that on hold because we had problems with the line extension cost for 3K's power. Nonetheless, I spent a lot of time studying the solar problem. We developed a business plan on how to do it as a community-owned project. In fact, that was the name of the business. We're fairly familiar with all the pros and cons of the different types of technologies that are out there. This white paper brings up one I think that deserves some evaluation by this commission. Energy storage, as you may be aware, has dropped dramatically in its cost. Tesla has kind of thrown down the gauntlet on the industry and said, here's the best patents and this technology is going to this price point, see if you can catch us. And this has major implications for how a solar project will be developed because it's now possible to integrate energy storage with a solar array. And the way you use the storage will change the whole way you look at it. It's no longer this intermittent spiky thing that has to be somehow innovated, sort of with band-aids. It's actually something that can be on equal footing with traditional power plants. Allows you to, for example, avoid using three-phase power because you just meter out to get the electricity as you see fit and meet have demand on it to whatever distribution line happens to be in the vicinity. If you want to use the solar power at night, you just simply extend the solar array and store more electricity during the daytime. So this report, which has a spreadsheet attached with it, it basically develops a model of what this could look like if you were to choose to build out a what I call a solar power challenge, which is to put out 500 megawatts of solar by the year 2027 using these technologies. The trend line is pretty strong. I think you'll see, just as you've seen with semiconductors, the prices of your equipment you have is going to continue to go down on an exponential scale. This change in this energy storage is a good example of that. If you looked around even as recently as a year ago, it would have cost four times as much for the same amount of energy storage. So this report divides into two sections. One's kind of a technical and economic assessment of the technology and what it would look like. Even with the things that I've talked about, as far as 500 megawatts of solar, it would occupy less than half of 1%, basically 10,000 acres out of the almost 6 million acres in Vermont. The other part of it deals with land use. I was formerly a planning commissioner, and I think there are an awful lot of opportunities for improving the process by which we cite, but it does require education of planning commissioners to a level that's never been seen before. So that's actually one of the main recommendations. This report actually was written for me, by me for the clean energy, the comprehensive energy plan, as basically a goal set for that plan. And I invite people to examine it and submit their comments or send comments to the commissioners. I would recommend the commission open up either a website or an email list for the public so that the communications can be a little bit more open than they are currently.
We will do that, and thank you. Thanks, George. I mean, the setting up this meeting happened pretty quickly and pretty chaotically. Not only has my deputy commissioner left me, but so has my assistant. And so it's been a little lonely in the commissioner's office these days.
Done, Chris.
We're getting there. Yeah, exactly. I know, right? Exactly. So we're catching up, is what I guess I'm saying. And there will be a web page. And yeah, people should think about not only comments to this task force, but as I said, the comprehensive energy plan is undergoing review now too. We did some public sessions and receiving comments on that. We're going to try and do draft of that by September, so that should help, you know, be another option. So.
My own bias, my opinion is that if, since solar is really available everywhere, if you scale it appropriately and if you put the locus of control of the management of the array in the local community, you'll have a much different paradigm than you currently have today. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the explanation here and why the solar cooperative was organized the way it was in fact to achieve that very goal. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Chris, can you tell folks to send electronic copies of there, if they have them, it would be
yes. Could folks please send electronic copies if they have them?
You'll put that.
Yeah, I'm just telling you.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I mean, I.
Do you have like a email address at this point assigned for that?
Send them to Ann.
Yeah, so don't send them to Chris.
Ann Margolis. Ann.Margolis@vermont.gov. By the way, all of our state email addresses is the way you get this information out. They've all changed from state.vt.us to vermont.gov as of yesterday. So, something good to know.
You want us to send them to Ann?
Vermont is spelled out. Yes, please.
At.
Ann Margolis, Ann.Margolis@vermont.gov.
Ann with an E, if I remember correctly.
Yes, it's Ann with an E.
Okay.
Thanks.
My name is Kathleen Nelson. I'm from Brighton, Mullins Island Pond, Essex County. Just so you all know, Essex County has been violently hit twice by wind developers. Hundreds of thousands of dollars have been spent to try and protect the natural resources of Essex County, including the Seneca Mountain. As an individual, the House Energy Committee, who pretty much has says he doesn't want to hear from the neighbors, okay, and who has had total disregard for the terrible situation that these two sets of developers put us in. Essex County houses has a DC power line system from Hydro Quebec that runs through the Silvio Conti National Refuge. We've done our share. We've destroyed a part of the National Refuge for clean hydro power. So the thing to cover those ridges and those mounts out there with industrial wind turbines is absurd. The chair of the Energy Committee, the House Energy Committee, seems to think that we're anti-business. We're an anti-business bunch of people who oppose this. But in fact, our business in the Northeast Kingdom is tourism, the biggest business in the whole state. I dare anyone in this room to show me a tourist brochure of Vermont that shows, come see our wind turbines, come see our solar arrays. There's no place for it up there. As far as siting goes, the issue up in the Northeast Kingdom is that tourism is our business, protection of the land is our responsibility. We have done our part. That Hydro Quebec line, that DC line, if anybody has seen it, is massive. And most of the time it feeds power into southern New England. The Energy Generation Siting Commission, prior to this one, was created as an election year distraction. That's all it was. It amounted to nothing. The H-40 Act 56 created this distraction. This is a developer-driven task force. There is no citizen representation on this task force. I'm sorry if you don't feel that way.
Okay.
You're not.
You're entitled.
You're not one of us. You're one of them. And I just want to make it clear to you that you have no idea how many people have been hurt by the lack of attention to the people of Vermont. Brighton was actually responsible for pointing out that Met Towers are not energy generation facilities. They're financial instruments for a developer. So what happens? Somebody over in the State House comes up with Section 246 to expedite Met Towers. Those should have fallen under Act 250. Now you have an incident out in Swanton where somebody put up a Met Tower for 4 years without getting a CPG, and he's going to get a slap on the wrist. His name is Tricky. He'll get a slap on the wrist for that. Not the $100,000 fine that he should get. Yes, I'm angry. Yes, I am angry. I have watched my community be divided. I have seen fights broken out. I have seen crime, signs stolen, lies. We even had a developer try to convince our autonomous water commissioner to put four wind turbines on our water source protection land. Okay? You people, you don't have any power. We the people have the power. And this time we're going to take it. We're going to take it this time. We're not going to listen to what any developers have to say. You're going to listen to what we have to say. Thank you.
Anyone else want to talk? Yes.
Excuse me, I'm going to sit down. My legs aren't
real good. Yep, please.
I'm Carol Irons. I live in Albany. I prepared a statement, so I'm going to read it, maybe comment a minute after. I know that I thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. And while this hearing is focused on solar array siting issues, the issues are mostly the same as those of industrial wind projects, and some of us have been trying to give testimony and, as Kathy said, ignored for a long time. The industrial scale of such projects, solar or wind, wipes out wetlands, clear cuts forest acreage, and destroys productive agricultural lands. Because of the good that these intact ecosystems provide, like water purification, heat and carbon absorption, wildlife nurturing, food production, and economic producing functions, we are in fact destroying the very environments that limit global warming. This is madness. Can we really destroy ecosystems to save the earth? The plain truth is that, quotes, renewable energy is a fantasy. It's a corporate fantasy. Industrial energy development is not renewable. Without exception, it is destructive. The construction requirements and the technology are massively destructive. Those of us living with it can tell you that. So considering the siting criteria is a red herring. It was a political ploy by a progressive representative, David Zuckerman, to block the effort to even pause this headlong rush to savage our natural resources. And that was for the short-term profit of the energy empire. The legislators and the state agencies have, in their various rulings and manipulations, betrayed Vermont. The whole convoluted system, from exempting the energy empire from Act 250 to hearings whose only real purpose is to perpetuate the illusion of democracy, to Tony Klein's dead-ending of the very siting issues that you purport to hear, this system works to enable the corporate agendas. So where do we go from here? I'm talking about a very different value system. And what Kathy shared with you is if there are pockets all over the state that are talking like this, you will tell us that you'll actually hear us and address our concerns. I don't believe you will, because I don't believe you can. Vermont's administration and legislature are too corrupt. They're run now by greedy corporations. Are you aware of the level of frustration out there? Do you know how much anger there is out there, and it is growing? You don't want to hear it, but it's there. I'm not trying to threaten you, but I'm trying to raise your concern because we keep talking past each other. The people out there have a different value system, and they're talking one thing, and folks that work in an administrative bubble are using good terminology and talking good things, but it doesn't translate into what we're living with out there. There are more and more people using the R word. R meaning revolution. I'm hearing this more and more. Well, we're all aware that we don't have a democracy anymore. We don't live in a democracy, we live in a corporatocracy. That's what we're all, those of us out there who aren't shielded by the administrative bubble, that's what we live with. So there will have to be a rising. The question is only what the nature of it will be, and at this point, that is unknown. If we are very lucky, if there arises some inspired and courageous leadership, it could be a soft revolution. Many of us truly hope for that, but it will require a dramatic change of values. We do not need to generate more energy, we need to use less. Energy that's being generated now is often sold out of state. This is not our need, so we shouldn't be sacrificed for it. We do not need or want to give over our healthy natural resources to corporations. We need to focus on local homeowner, small-scale management of energy development and use. And we desperately need to stop all of these unneeded electricity generation development that does nothing to ease climate change. I really hope you'll start listening, because I'm not trying to threaten anybody, I'm trying to caution you. There's a real growing anger out there.
Thank you, Carol.
And a lot of us are, I have had no interest in coming here, I was urged to come here. I didn't want to, because I'm getting tired of this, because I feel like I'm just, there's just a game going here, and I think you all are well-meaning, you're talking the talk, but it's in a bubble that has nothing to do with blasting mountaintops or polluting rivers or filling in wetlands. The three drivers throughout rural Vermont is tourism, agricultural activities of various kinds, and outdoor recreation. And there's a bazillion small businesses and hundreds of thousands of people who earn their living with those things. And what's going on with these corporations doing massive industrial scale development is destroying those resources that produce the food, that produce the activities, and that produce, you know, the people coming and then going to the small businesses and so on. We're killing ourselves. And we're going to fight that.
Hey, thank you very much. Yes.
Guy Pate, you want an energy partnership? From Ms. Standard.
Please, and be quick, because I'm not sure you're the last one, but you're pretty close.
Guy Pate from One Energy Partnership. Actually, it's a question for Bob. The distributed generation, you said it'll be positive for helping us adapt to extreme weather. I guess I don't understand how it's expected to work, and especially in that regard. Can you just give us some more information?
Briefly, if you want to respond to that, but that may be something we want to investigate more later.
Sure. So I think people have read the chart microgrids. So microgrids, again, we see that as the future, where individual homes, individual infrastructures, individual towns will be able to disconnect from the grid, and for whatever reason, but as storms become more fierce, as you may have heard us talk about, when it comes to Mother Nature and our poles and wires, when Mother Nature hit those poles and wires with like those twigs and twine, they come down. You've seen that in recent storms. Last December, $15 million storm. We need to plan for the future where we have local generation, where we can keep lights on when those storms hit and the large power lines go down. Our key infrastructures will be supported with electricity, and that will happen later.
Anyone else want to say anything? Yes, Joey.
I'm Johanna Miller. I'm the Energy Program Director at the Vermont Natural Resources Council, and I really appreciate the work that you're all doing here today and are going to do, because we clearly understand these are not, as we have heard, simple issues. They have a lot of consequences. So I just want to acknowledge that for my organization, we care a lot about natural resources, unfragmented forests, clean water, farmland, compact, walkable communities. We also care about clean energy and climate change and the state getting to its greenhouse gas emission and renewable energy goals. So we definitely recognize that there is a tension among some of these issues and really appreciate the work that you're doing to try and resolve some of those issues. Welcome, you're invited to one of our staff meetings at some point to really see. We feel like we're a microcosm of some of what's going on here in terms of the really sort of pull on some of these issues. But it's one of the reasons we urge the creation of the Energy Generation Siting Policy Commission, and I would urge you, I didn't hear it necessarily as much as I'd like to really start from the foundation of using that package of recommendations as a framework for your sort of solutions. It's also one of the reasons that we appreciate the work that's happening at the three regional planning commissions with the deep energy planning, and we really hope that there's far more of that happens in terms of the planning and implementation. We also recognize that we have a responsibility to do our part in terms of empowering our lives and living in a civil society in the 21st century. and that it hasn't been talked a lot about here, but one of the things that really is a frame for VNRC and the issues that we care about is recognizing that we, you know, there's a crisis when we're talking about climate change, and no, Vermont cannot solve the climate crisis alone, but it's really important, and there's another reasons why we're doing these things. I just wanted to share one of the closing paragraphs. I don't know if anyone read it, but last week, NASA's climate scientist, James Hansen, released a report, and along with several others, and they don't mince words. So I just thought I'd share the last statement of their report. It's about the sea level rise, and concludes this way. We conclude that continued high emissions will make multi-meter sea level rise practically unavoidable and likely to occur this century. Social disruption and economic consequences of such large sea level rise could be devastating. It is not difficult to imagine that conflicts arising from forced migrations and economic collapse might make the planet ungovernable, threatening the fabric of civilization. That's their concluding paragraph. And I would just say it's also a frame whereby which I hope you do really good work.
Thanks.
I just have a quick question.
Yes.
Someone passed around a list with email addresses. Uh-huh. Is there any way we could can we share that?
I will ask the non-public members of our committee whether they want to release those, because we signed on that list too.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be really nice to be able to communicate with other people in the room.
I'm not sure what people's intention were signing up, whether they expected that those would be distributed.
So, Chris, one idea is with the Siting Commission, the commission chair had it all, took the emails and then distributed them to everybody else, so that it let the private members stay private and yet get the direct communications from.
Well, we can certainly, that's a good idea for getting information out, and we can do that. I think sharing among yourselves will be more problematic, and you'll just have to make friends with the people.
Thank
here.
Thank
okay.
you.
Anyone else need to feel like they need to say anything that hasn't had a chance? Okay, last thing on the agenda. Anything else on the agenda to deal with? Any other business? Motion to, yes, sir. I just want to know that it is exactly 3 o'clock. We started exactly at 1 o'clock, and it is exactly 3 o'clock. So don't mess up my day.
All right.
Senator Gray.
No, I just wanted to say, you know, thank you. So I was revealing my inner policy nerd side. Back in, there was an Olympics, I don't know, 20 years ago, when the first time the NBA players could be in, they called that team the Dream Team. So for me, as a legislator wanting to work on this issue, as corny as it may sound, and thinking about it and dreaming of who could be on such a team. So you are, for Vermont Solar Siting, like the Dream Team. You cover all the bases. This is, you know, I said it is a little corny, but this is, to me, this meeting is a great start, and from the things I heard around the room, it's both inspiring and sober. I mean, they're some real challenges here, so I know a lot of work ahead. I'll be happy to quietly help in whatever way I can. For anyone who doubts the interest, the genuine interest of the legislature in addressing this, I can assure you that there are many people who want to make real progress, and this is not a happy talk exercise. This is a sincere effort, and I know it is for all of you, so I thank you.
Thanks. I would entertain
motion
a motion to adjourn. Thank you.
Seconded.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all very much.